Hey, this is Joe Hubbard from JoeHubbardBassVideos.com coming at you today with another lesson. And this particular lesson is on chord superimposition. So with that in mind, grab your bass and let's get started. Chord superimposition is a concept based on playing lines on top of the original chord changes that are based on a different set of chords. The reason this concept works is because the superimposed chords contain notes from the original chord, including chord tones and tensions. This principle is not to be confused with chord substitution, which is based on changing the original harmonic progression. With chord superimposition, we keep the original chord changes, but instead play lines on top of those changes that are based on a different set of chords. What we're going to take a look at in this lesson is exploring some of the possibilities of taking a minor seventh lick and superimposing it over different chord types, including minor seventh, dominant seventh, and major seventh chords. It's way beyond the scope of this video to cover all the possibilities, but hopefully this will give you a glimpse of how chord superimposition can work for you. What we're doing here is taking a 2-beat C minor 7 lick and then going through some of the superimposition possibilities over different chord types. One of the stumbling blocks when using superimposition is not being able to reference the original chord that you're playing over. So to solve that problem, we're simply going to punctuate the lick or frame it with an ascending and descending arpeggio outlining the original chord. Now, in the example that you just heard, I demonstrated this framing concept over a C minor seventh chord. So I played the C minor seventh arpeggio going up and then played the C minor lick and then descended back down a C minor seventh arpeggio. Now, no actual superimposition has taken place yet, but this just serves to explain the methodology that we're going to use in subsequent chord types. So let's break down this lick. The lick is based on a 2-beat 16th note pattern over a funk groove, and I've got a chromatic approach note from below to a double chromatic above, and then another chromatic below the flat 3. And then from the flat 3, I'm ascending to the 5th, playing a scale passing tone in between. So I've got the flat 3, then the 4, then the 5, or E flat, F, and G. And then I end on the flat 7, which is B flat. So the whole lick. Now notice the technique of framing is I'm actually going to play the arpeggio that we're superimposing this over. Now, in the lick you just heard, I explained that no superimposition is taking place, but this is a good place to start. We've got a C minor 7 lick. Let's start here. So I ascend with the C minor 7 arpeggio, then play the lick, and then descend back down the C minor 7 arpeggio. And what that does is a couple of things. It allows you to hear the full chord sound, and it also allows you to expand upon this 2-beat lick. So now I've got, instead of this, I've got this, which is kind of a cool concept. Now what we're going to be doing is taking this lick. I'm going to show you how we can take this lick and then superimpose it over three different chord types. So stay with me. In this next example, what we're going to do is start the superimposition process by superimposing our C minor seventh lick over a minor seventh chord of fifth below. So what we've got here is this, where I'm taking an F minor seventh chord and I'm arpeggiating it, and then I'm playing my C minor 7 lick and then descending back down the F minor 7 arpeggio. Now, it's important to understand why this works. Why this works is that if I take that C minor seventh chord and analyze the notes in regard to F minor seven, it brings out particular chord tones and tensions of the F minor seven. So what I've got here, what was the root 3, 5 and seven, or root flat 3, 5 and flat seven of my C minor seven, is now the 5, flat 7, 9, and 11 of my F minor seventh chord. And these would be the notes that I'd resolve to. So when I'm playing that line, that's the way you're hearing it over F minor 7. You're hearing that as the flat 7, the 9, and the 11. It's sort of highlighting those particular notes, and that gives you a very cool sound. So far we saw how we just took it over C minor 7, where it's just a C minor 7 pattern, and then we've now superimposed this over an F minor 7. Now, what's also really cool about the whole concept is that I don't have to think about 9s and 11s and 13s. All I need to think about is the root 3, 5, and 7 of the chord that I'm superimposing. So I need to know the theory, but the idea is that while I'm actually playing, I don't have to process all of those ideas of chord tensions. I can just think of the root 3, 5, and 7 of my C minor fits a fifth above the F minor 7. So we're taking this concept one step further now by superimposing our C minor seventh lick a flatted fifth above a dominant seventh chord. Now this is going to give us some cool sound. So we have C minor seven over F sharp dominant seven. So the C minor seventh chord, as far as the notes, the way they apply, we're going to have sharp 11, we're going to have 13, we're going to have flat 9, and then we're going to have 3. So this is very cool. So I'm going to ascend up this F sharp dominant seventh chord, play my lick, and then descend back down. So it sounds a little outside. Very cool sound, almost sounds like a Mike Stern lick. Very simple concept to take, and by breaking these down into two halves and then putting it into one whole, you can see something much more clear in its actual application. Remember I said that you don't have to use this framing technique all the time when you play. I could just take the two-beat phrase. But what it does when I practice is it enables me to hear the chord that I'm trying to superimpose the phrase over. In this next exercise, what we're going to do is take our C minor 7 lick and superimpose this over a major 7th chord a half step above. And in this context, that'd be D flat major 7. Superimposing the C minor 7, I'm going to have 7, 9, sharp 11, and 13. Now applying this framing concept to our C minor 7 lick, this is what we're going to have. Beautiful, rich sound. Okay, so what I want you to do is get this down in every key. Very important to learn what you do in every key. It's vital. Also, slow it down. Don't be so quick to turn on that metronome and drum machine before you learn and sort of get it integrated into your mind and your muscle memory. Do that first. Then afterwards, you know, do what you want. Play with play-alongs. Play with drum machines, play with metronomes. Also, make sure to download the PDF that comes with this lesson and follow along with that. Okay, you know what to do. Go practice. It's important to point out that the reason this concept works is that it follows the laws of music. Any chord that is superimposed on top of another chord is comprised of a collection of chord tones and tensions that are derivative from the original chord. We can use any melodic embellishments on the superimposition, but we must always remember to resolve on the root 3, 5, and 7 of the superimposed chord. Well, I hope you enjoyed watching this and got a glimpse of the important aspects of this lesson and how they can work for you. There are two characteristics that will successfully get your playing up to a good level. The first is developing a desire to do it, and the second is having an organized methodology of study. This is where I come in. By joining my online school, JoeHubbardBassVideos.com, the level of intensity of your desire is entirely up to you. You can study with me at a full-on pace if you have that natural go-for-it attitude, but if you feel more comfortable within the time that you have, going at a slower pace, then this is fine too. The key is continual improvement and having fun by developing a solid musical foundation proven by the ability to play through the lesson material and realizing that you are the one who's doing it. Until next time, practice smart, work hard, and play creatively.